Hey, we got an event coming up Saturday, October 24th. It's going to be in the middle of the afternoon, 2 o'clock to 5 o'clock. It's going to be in Bucyrus at Shines Art Park. It's going to be, it's called Fall Jesus Jamboree. So there's going to be a praise team that's going to be there. There's going to be gospel proclamation. So what I want it to be, it's going to be kind of like praise and worship music, a sermon burst. We're going to be talking about hope, finding hope in this dark, fallen world. There's going to be cider, there's going to be donuts, but what I want you guys to do is tell your friends and neighbors. And I want the people, we're going to go with Canvas, Cyrus, and all that, and talk to people and try to get as many people there, because I want this to be people who don't have a relationship with God. I want them to come. People who are on the fence with God. People who are just curious about God. I want to show them that God is real, and that we come and worship and praise Him. But I want you to bring your friends and family, because it's going to be a night of believers worshiping as well. So believers gathering around those who might not be believers. So I want everybody there that you can get to go shake the shrubs and bushes and kick down the doors. So October 24th, a couple Saturdays from now, 2 to 5.
Can you announce about the spaghetti dinner too?
And we're doing a fundraiser. Oh, you got a slide there. We're doing a fundraiser. You talk about it, because I don't know the details of it.
Can you move the slide, Michelle, to the spaghetti dinner?
It's up here.
Move it back, I think. We announced this last week too, but we're doing a benefit spaghetti dinner fundraiser for a community member. This is for final funeral expenses for Eleanor B. Muling. This will be Saturday, October 17th from 4 to 7. Will be at the Likens Community Hall. It will be dine-in and also drive-through, if you would like. So Ignite is sponsoring that. If you have any questions or anything, you can talk to me or Brian. Thank you.
So, all right. We are without our fearless leader today. We could use your prayers tonight as we play together, that we do play together. But it's a blessing to be here and to worship the Lord, and so let's pray. Dear Father, we praise you and we thank you, Lord, for this blessed, glorious time to come together in your name, Lord. We just pray that you will be blessed tonight, Lord God, that your word would go forth, Lord, and take root in our hearts. And Lord, we would go out renewed in your spirit and ready to serve you and make your name known in this dark world. And we'll give you all praise in Jesus' name. Amen.
Angels.
Thank you. We praise you, Father. Thank you for your goodness and mercies never fail. Lord God, I just pray your word would go forth now, and we'll give you the praise in Jesus' name. Amen.
Smiling faces out there. Girls in the back, you guys ready? Okay, you got your Sherman notes you guys are going to be doing today? There's three things that I want you guys to remember, that as we're going through the Sermon on the Mount, being conformed, operating in love, and what our motivation is, we're going to be talking a little bit about. Before that, let's go to the throne and ask God to just bless this time together. Lord, first we're going to lift up Faith, the Inmans, the whole Inman clan. They've got different ailments going on at the house, Lord. We just pray you can touch them and heal them and make them whole in each in their own individual way, Lord. And for those friends and family who have lost loved ones this very recently, Lord, I pray that you can just speak into their lives, Lord, that they're going to need to step out in faith, Lord. Step out in faith when they, I mean, some of these, my aunt was married for over 40 years, normal over 50 years. These are decades where they're with people, Lord, that they love and cherish. And now, Lord, they had to step out in faith, Father. And I know you'll be there to guide them each and every step of the way, Lord. We just pray for this message. Thank you for the praise music that is provided, that we give glory to you in all this, Lord. And just help me to speak things that are edifying, that we go out of here more spiritually. Our vitality is heightened spiritually, Lord, as we leave this place, to bring more glory to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. So we're going through the Sermon on the Mount, and Jesus is saying last week, you've heard it said this. This is what the law of old said, but I tell you this. And people were like, whoa, what? Now, don't get me wrong. Well, there's probably nobody there that said, I got this. I can do this. I can love my enemies with a perfect love. I cannot look on the opposite sex to lust after them. I got this. There was nobody there that said, I got this. Only thing you can do, there he is. The only thing you can do is make sure as you do these things. Now there's sanctification that's going on. So these people that are around him, Jesus was talking to believers. There might have been unbelievers there, but believers were the only ones that can receive this stuff. Believers are the only ones that can go out and live by the spirit of the law and not by just the old law in the flesh. So Jesus has to be in your life in order for any of this to be functional. Now, the Sermon on the Mount, he was illustrating. He said, can you imagine him starting off saying, okay, you want to know what the kingdom of God looks like? I'm going to show you what the kingdom of God looks like and what citizens of that kingdom look like. And then he goes through, blessed are the broken in spirit, the poor in spirit. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst after righteousness. And he goes on and on showing what this spirit will look like in them. So today, as we go through, we're going to start in chapter 6. He's going to be talking about giving to the needy. Now, we're talking about love in Sunday school. Love, as you become a child of God, you need to be operating in love. That should be how you're always operating, is in love. You're being conformed to the image of God. Be conformed to the image of God's Son, Jesus Christ, as it says in Romans chapter 8. He says that the believers are predestined to be conformed to the image of Jesus Christ, of His Son. So, we are predestined. God has already got it on His calendar of events before we were even in existence. Before the world was even in existence, God knew that He would be taking the believers in Him, those who have been given new life, those who are born again by the blood of Jesus, born from above, that He would be taking them on a journey of what we call sanctification, on a journey where they're now raised in new life. Now Jesus is good, or God is going to change us, our image. He wants our image to be bearers of His Son. He wants us to be image bearers of Christ Jesus. And that's what He's going to be doing, conforming us to look like Jesus. That happens through love. We're operating in love. He's going to be talking about hypocrites in here. That word hypocrite in the Greek means play actor. A play actor. Somebody who's putting on a show. And I heard one woman years and years ago, she said, "Hey, why don't you come over to my church? We're for real. We don't play church," she said. "We don't play church." And she was passionate about it because she had been to churches that was playing church. Okay? When you are the church, you are the body of Christ. So, what is your motivational factor? As we go through these things, Jesus is going to be getting at the heart of motivation. What is your motivation for doing these things? Here's how I want you to operate. Here's what a citizen of my kingdom is going to look like. And you're not going to do it by any physical hoops you jump through, by any physical inheritance you get. You're only going to be able to be conformed to the image of God's Son by the grace operating in you, the grace that comes from His Spirit indwelling you. You can't do these things as a person in the world, living according to the flesh, who is spiritually dead, because these are spiritual things. So if you're going to be operating in spiritual vitality and operating by spirit power, you obviously cannot be spiritually dead. So Jesus is telling these things to believers, and they're going, wait a second, this bar is too high. This man is too holy. He's calling sinners to do things that only holy, perfect, righteous people can do. Guess what? Jesus did set the bar high. He set it perfectly high. Because He's the only one who can do it. He's the only one that can make atonement for our sins. And His back is the only one we can get on. We can't go through this in our own power. But we can't just roll over and play dead either. Because God's saying, "I'm going to give you my Spirit that's going to dwell in you. You're going to be conformed to the image of Jesus." So we're going to be looking more and more like Jesus the more we go along. And our motivation is going to be changed. When I lived in the world, when I was doing things that didn't care anything about God, my motivations were for me. My secondary motivations were for myself. My thirdary motivations were for anything me. Is that thirdary a word? Secondary, third. My third. Thirdary. It was all about me. What can I get for myself? How can I benefit? How can I get the most? How can I get the most whatever? And I was heat mitigated, and I was getting so much, I was sowing so much to the flesh that I had to build bigger barns, and I had to tear down the old barns. And I was just sowing so much to the flesh. And that's nothing. That's all going to be eaten by moss and rust and stolen by thieves. My motivation was not God glorifying. And as we're going to see when we go through here, the motivating factor in your life of a believer should be to point to God, to point to Jesus Christ. When somebody looks at you and says, "Man, you've really changed," okay? That word, being conformed to the image of Christ, means changed. We're being changed. When somebody looks at you and says, "Man, you've changed," you can't go, "That's right. I took all these books and watched all these tapes, and I started praying these certain prayers, and I'm feeling a whole lot better and doing a lot better things." That's not what it is. I've changed because Jesus Christ is in me. That's the change. So when I'm glorifying God in anything, it's going to be in everything that I do as a believer. It points to God. Here I am. Here's where I was. Grace was added to it. And all glory goes to God. So Jesus is going to talk about motivations because a fallen heart, it motivates to glorify itself. And Jesus says, "You abide in me, I abide in you." There's a lot of abiding going on, especially reading the Gospel of John. There's a lot of abiding going on. But abiding in love, that means love motivates how we operate. Our motivation is to glorify God. We do it in the spirit of love. And as we're doing it, we're being conformed to the image of God. So let's go ahead. We're going to start. I want you guys to remember that. Did you guys get that? Being conformed to the image of God, Jesus' Son, or God's Son Jesus, operating in love and a God-glorifying motivation. So this wasn't just some guy who graduated in a doctorate degree that's up here preaching. This wasn't somebody who was just bored on a Saturday afternoon and decided to go up and talk to people about how he thought life should be. This is God Almighty in the flesh proclaiming these spiritual truths. Now people, here's the kingdom of God, and here is how it operates, and here are the citizens who occupy the kingdom of God. So that's how a sermon goes. What is your motivation? Is it to point people to Jesus? Or is it to look at me, guys? Look over here at me. Let's read a little bit. Chapter 6, verse 1. Beware of practicing your righteousness before other people in order to be seen by them. For then you have no reward from your Father who is in heaven. Thus, when you give to the needy, sound no trumpet before you, as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets, that they may be praised by others. Truly I say to you, they have received their reward. But when you give to the needy, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your giving may be in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. So again here, what is your motivation? Is it to say, look at all the zeros on this check. Tenfold, you count them zeros, five zeros that I'm giving to the school. Is that how you're motivated? To get your glory? To show everybody how awesome you are? That's not what it's about. And God says, right there, whatever people say, man, that guy is generous. Man, he's really got a heart for the school. That's your reward. It ends there. There's no treasures being stored up in heaven. You just got your reward, and for that donation, you have no treasures or no blessings coming from God. Because you flaunted it, and you're saying, look at me, look at me. Do it in secret. It's a motivating factor. What is your motivation? Is it to glorify God, or to glorify yourself? So as we go through these, do unto the Lord or to be seen by man? That's basically, you can check the boxes as you go through stuff. If you're helping somebody cross the street, or you're opening the door, are you doing it because you're operating in love? And at the end of the day, God gets the glory. Or are you doing it to be seen by other people? Are you doing it to get a pat on your back and attaboy? True worship results from the desire to serve God, not man. So when you're giving donations or your time or whatever you're doing, make sure you're motivated properly to be seen of God or to serve God, not man. Because lost rewards occur by gaining the reward of human recognition. If that's the end in itself, is human recognition, then that's all you're going to get is your reward. That's a physical reward. There's no spiritual reward there. Because you're operating in the flesh, not in the spirit. So, the Lord's Prayer. Let's jump right into it. So, this is the most famous prayer everyone knows. I mean, even all the churches that have doctrinal issues, different denominations, they all concur on the Lord's Prayer. It's exalted as such. So let's go ahead through it. And when you pray, you must not be like the hypocrites. Remember that word hypocrite means play actor. So in this Greek, if this was a Greek Bible, it would say, and when you pray, you must not be like the play actors. Those who are playing church. Those who are acting like the body of Christ, but aren't really the body of Christ. They're play acting. And when you pray, you must not be like the hypocrites, for they love to stand and pray in the synagogue and street corners, that they may be seen of others. Truly I say to you, they have received their reward. But when you pray, go into your room and shut the door, and pray to your Father who is in secret. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you. And when you pray, do not heap up empty phrases as the Gentiles do, for they think that they will be heard for their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask Him. Pray then like this. So Jesus is going to give this great prayer. This template, this outline, this perfect representation of what prayer should look like. And it begins with an exclamation. Then there are six petitions that give proper priorities. The first three focus on the preeminence of God, and the last three focus on personal needs within a community context. So, the beginning exclamation, Jesus says, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done. You could, volumes could be said just on Our Father. Right away, Jesus is showing, who are you praying to? This is a father-child relationship that God has for you. Just as parents who don't have mental issues or spiritual issues are loving to their kids. They want the best for their kids. They have the utmost protection and perseverance of their kids and their livelihood and their health and all everything they want the kid to be sustained and satisfied fully. That's the relationship God has with us. It doesn't say our God in heaven, which it could. It says our Father in heaven. Jesus is showing that relationship of one who has the most sincere and loving intentions and desires for his children. Our Father in heaven, hallowed, that is, that word means holy. Holy be your name. Holy. Why does it say holy there? Why doesn't he say righteous be your name, graceful be your name, loving be your name? Do you know the angels were around the throne, were saying holy, 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 the Lord God Almighty? That's the only time you see those words lumped together in threes. Why? When they're showing that that is a preeminence of God's holiness. They are enunciating God's holiness. They don't say grace, 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 Lord God Almighty. They don't say love, love, love. These are all attributes of God that he does have. God is love. God is full of grace. They don't say merciful, merciful, merciful is the Lord God Almighty. They say holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. So when you're praying this prayer and you say holy is your name, you understand, okay, this is why the kingdom of God looks so holy, perfectly holy. Only God can be holy. And this is why the citizens of that kingdom must also be holy. Must also be living out a holy life. It says, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And that's the best way. We don't want our wills to be done. We want what we think we want to be done. But we pray the best way to pray is, I said all this, Lord, and I know that this is my desires. Yes, we want this sick person healed. Yes, we want them restored. Yes, we want these bones to come back together and then to walk again. This is what we want, Lord. But we pray your will be done. Because it's not a wishy-washy will. It's not an imperfect will. It is a perfect will. There's no better way God can do something that can't be improved upon. God's will cannot be improved upon. He's not going to go back and say, eternal Son of God, we really blew that one. Holy Spirit, why didn't you say something when I was thinking of that? Why didn't we have a plan B? The triune Godhead is not going to look back on something he did and say, man, we should have done something different. Or man, the Holy Spirit's not going to go, God the Father, I told you we should have done it another way. They're in perfect harmony and their will is perfectly executed so that it cannot be added to and made any better than it already is. Wouldn't you want to put your life into someone's hand who has the perfect plan and purpose for sin? His purpose is to be conformed to the image of his Son. Okay, I was going to throw this out here. If you could have your image conformed to anyone who ever lived or ever will live, wouldn't it be the Son of God, the eternal Son of God, the Savior of the world? And that's who God is conforming our image to. The best of the best. So we're praying, your will be done, your kingdom come. Because even though his kingdom might seem backwards to us, because it is backwards, we don't say, what? Love your enemies. That's, no, you got that wrong, God. Are you sure that's what you meant? Or is it tolerate your enemies? Is it put up with your enemies and build bigger fences? No, it's love your enemies. Let's go on. Give us this day our daily bread. So we're asking God for provision. God says, seek ye first the kingdom of heaven and his righteousness, and these things will be added unto you. What's that? He's not talking about money. He's not talking about fame and fortune. He's talking about place to live, clothes to wear, food to eat. He will sustain you. God is your sustainer. Give us this day our bread and forgive us our debts, as we have also forgiven our debtors. And I think the most important part of that is, as we have forgiven our trespassers, those who have sinned against us, those who have trespassed against us. Jesus doesn't say, and forgive us our sins, as we also will forgive those who sin against us. He doesn't say, forgive our debts, as we may forgive. He's already saying it as this is going to happen because you are a believer, and the only way you can operate as a believer is to forgive people who have wronged you. Do you know that I'm going to a cross? Well, they didn't know that at the time. But Jesus is going to show the perfect imagery, the perfect example of forgiving those who trespass against you. He did that on that blood-soaked cross, was showing how to forgive those who trespass against you. And he says, forgive our debtors, also as we forgive. We forgive. He doesn't say maybe. He doesn't say if we get around to it. He doesn't say if that's the inkling we have. He says, forgive us our debts as we also forgive our debtors. Now I put some of these up here because these people scratch their head a lot at the next one. And he says, and lead us not into temptation. Okay, God tests people. God, and through a testing, through trials, you grow. Or you're revealed. A weakness is revealed in you, which you can improve upon. But God tested. God tested Abraham with his son Isaac. He put him through a trial. He put Job through a trial. That on the other side, they will be shown their trueness of who they are and grow from it. So, allow us to be spared from difficult circumstances that would tempt us to sin. Is what he's saying. I'm not going to say a better way to say that. But that is what he's saying in essence when he says, lead us not into temptation. He's saying, allow us to be spared from difficult circumstances that would tempt us to sin. Remember, wherever there's temptation to sin, God always provides a way out. And deliver us from evil, or the evil one. Deliver us from the evil one. Okay, God, the best protection from sin and temptation is to turn to God and depend on His direction. We all know Proverbs 3. That's why I always stand on that. You guys know Proverbs 3? Lean not on your understanding and always acknowledge God. So, I'm coming to God. I'm asking Him to help and direct me. I'm going to lean on Him for my understanding. I'm going to allow Him to direct my path. Not Brian. I'll be lost and I'll be in a labyrinth and I will never get out and I will just be consumed if I follow my own direction. So deliver us from evil. Here's how you do that. You turn to God and depend on His direction. And remember, God has a will for your life. He has a purpose. Says His purpose is for you to be conformed to the image of His Son. So you can't say, I don't have no purpose in life. No, God has a purpose for you. And as you're being conformed to the image of His Son, you're going to be out there as the church, which is the body of Christ. So you're going to be the hands and feet. The feet go places, the hands do stuff. You're going to be doing. It says, let this mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus. So now you have the thoughts and mind of Christ. So you're going to be thinking like you should be, like Jesus. You're going to be doing things out of love. Your hands. You're going to be going places out of love. That's what the body of Christ is. Going out into this dark world with the light and the salt. That is the changed life through the Holy Spirit. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For if you forgive others their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. Wow, that's pretty stern stuff there. You have to have a heart that's forgiving. You have to have a heart that is looks at people not in their fallen state, but as a person under the curse of this world that sin brought, where you once were. So we look at somebody has saved us, Almighty God. Here's the way I look at it. Hey, two girls, come up here real quick. Or take your time and meander. One of the two. I need two of you up here. So, here's where I look at the gospel of Christ. Okay? Madeline, lay on the ground right here. Okay? So, closer to the steps. Avery, you come right here. So, this is what I look like as the gospel of Jesus Christ and what we are to do. Okay? So, God has rescued you, Ava. Okay? He has pulled you out of the pit of despair. Give your hand. Now, God has you, and I'll pick her up. That's what. Now, you see that illustration? Stay right there, Madeline. You see that illustration? Hold hands. I'm God. I have given my spirit. She has been forgiven of all her sins, and now she is living as a child of God. Now, I am holding her and empowering her, and now because she is empowered to pick someone else up out of that miry clay, out of the sinful world. So that's how God operates. Thank you, guys. God reaches down and saves me, and he keeps a hold of me, and I reach down to save someone else. And that, I learned from Peppa Pig what a daisy chain is, where you take the daisies, you split the thing, and you put the flower through. That's what it looks like. So now, from the time of Jesus making disciples to go out and make disciples, there's great daisy chains of God giving provision and renewing people, and then picking someone out of the pit. Another person picking someone out of the pit. But you follow those chains of arms that are picking people up, and it goes right back to the throne of God. And the God who descended in flesh to this world to provide us with that forgiveness and that new life. So all them arms are powered by Jesus Christ. So that's why it's so important that we forgive people, because it's such a great cost to forgive us. So that's a fasting phase. Let's see what it says here, because apparently that Pharisees and scribes and Sadducees and those people who thought they had it all figured out and were operating by all these laws of men and all these things, and they were trying to keep this and that. Meanwhile, they didn't care about the orphans or the widows. Meanwhile, they were draining people with their bank accounts. Meanwhile, they were giving excuses that you didn't have to take care of your parents after they become destitute or one of them died. You didn't have to help your mom out. They were giving all this crazy stuff. Let's see what he says. And when you fast, do not look gloomy like the hypocrites. They're against the hypocrites, the play actors. They're just acting the part, because their motivation is not to glorify God. Their motivation is to get pats on the back and to get attaboys and to get, now there goes a really spiritual guy. That's what they were getting, their own glory. And when you fast, do not look gloomy like the hypocrites, for they disfigure their faces that their fasting may be seen by others. Truly I say to you, they have received their reward. But when you fast, anoint your head and wash your face, that your fasting may not be seen by others, but by your Father who is in secret. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you. These are treasures in heaven. These are spiritual treasures. You're doing things out of a spiritual motivation as you operate in love. Okay? So when you're fasting, people should be able to tell that you're fasting. You're doing it to inflict your soul. You're doing it to inflict your body, that you may grow in grace with God. And God sees that and honors that. And you're in spiritual warfare. Do you know that? We pray, we fast. That's spiritual warfare. God says some of these demons they couldn't exercise out because they weren't fasting. He says some of these demons are stronger. They take a more spiritual dedication. They take a more spiritual hunger. And there he says these come out only by prayer and fasting. So they're saying, you want to cast these demons out, but you got to go deeper. You got to go harder. You got to go stronger. And you do that by fasting, which is physical restraint from food or water, and there's other ways you can fast. But that brings you to a point where you're inflicting yourself so God can grow you spiritually. Jesus was stronger after the 40 days, I believe, than he was weaker. Weak in the flesh, maybe, because he was hungry, but strong in his spirit, because he had afflicted his soul. The devil didn't have a chance with Jesus either way you look at it. But he came to Jesus on a 40-day fast, and Jesus fed him soul food. Gave him the word at every instance. So when you fast, do it, and don't bring contention to yourself. Remember, Jesus is saying your motivating factor should be giving glory to God. Lay up treasures in heaven. Now, if that was in my Grandpa Odie's backyard, he was still going to do something with it. Okay? No. Grandpa, I can get a truck and get me that out of here. No. I know exactly what I'm going to do with that. Lay up treasures in heaven. Verse 19. Do not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth where moth and rust destroy and where thieves break in and steal, but lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust destroys, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, your heart will be also. The eye is the lamp of the body. So if your eye is healthy, we'll get to that. That's rusted. That is what doing things out of wrong motivation is only for this world. There's no spiritual benefit, and there's no spiritual reward for it. When you're going out and you're doing things in the power and name of Jesus. You're going places in the power and name of Jesus. Your mind, you don't want treasures that you're going to leave. You can't take any of these physical treasures with you. You're going to be destroyed. They're going to be robbed. They're going to be eaten through, and they're going to be left behind. So make sure you have the proper motivation to glorify God. Abiding in love, that's your operation, is in love. And you're doing that through the Spirit of God. So we're going to talk about the eye. The eye is the lamp of the body, Jesus says. So in Jewish literature, the eye is similar to the heart. So as I read this, and we're going to close here, this is basically what he's saying. A healthy eye, clear vision, equals loyal devotion to God. A bad eye, impaired vision, equals moral corruption. So now as I read this, here's the good eye and the bad eye. And Jesus says, the eye is the lamp of the body. So if your eye is healthy, your whole body will be full of light. But if your eye is bad, your whole body will be full of darkness. If then the light in you is darkness, how great is that darkness? No one can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and money. There's all kinds of places in the Bible. I lay before you a blessing and a curse, Moses said. There's two trees. Both bear different fruit. One will lead to life. One will lead to death. There's two builders who build two different houses on two different foundations. One will crumble and one will stand. There's two paths with two different gates, with two different widths of roads that lead to two different places. It's your choice. You can't serve God and then you can fill that leg in with anything else. You can only serve God. Amen? So choose this day whom you will serve. As the band comes up, I'm going to close with prayer. Lord, give us the wisdom. You know what? As we follow you, Lord, that's what you're doing. You're giving us the wisdom. Well, we'll know what fruit to eat. We will know which road to take. We will know which foundation to build on. You give us that wisdom because you're conforming us to the image of your Son. If there's anybody here, Lord, who's saying, I'm not ready yet to be conformed to the image of the Son of God because I like my image, Lord, speak the, just give them a lightning bolt in their soul, Lord, that they say that is utter words of hell, Lord. I just pray that everybody in here, anybody listening out there in camera world, will know that today's the day you choose whom you will follow because you don't have tomorrow guaranteed. Lord, help these truths to just stay with us and help us to abide in love. We can only do it through your power in us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's stay in this worship.
My heart, so I can heal the world, take it.
being here tonight. I want you guys to go out and have a blessed week. Take those nasty faces out with you, all right? Shine that light in this dark world. Point people to heaven, amen? Amen. Point people to Jesus. Have a great week. Amen. Hey, did you guys do your sermon illustrations? Come up and get some candy. I see this. God is going to change us. Hallelujah. Point to God. Yeah. That is a really good Samson drawing you did. I like the ropes that he broke. Let's see.
Let the little ones be correct.
You need Jesus in your life. Yeah, yeah. God's Spirit is going to dwell in us. Yeah. That's good. Oh my goodness, is that Samson's hair or is that him breaking ropes?
That's his hair.
Oh, that's so cool. Okay.